There are two things, see. In the 70s, wildlife films or wildlife in general were becoming very popular throughout the world. And a lot of films were made in Africa, which was a much easier place to make. And in India, it was almost untouched, although we had a very big biodiversity, number of animals and number of beautiful animals. But the situation was difficult condition to film and so on, so nobody was venturing here. I was born in Haridwar, where my father worked, and we had very close contact with nature. My father was very much interested in wildlife, writing and photographing. And as children, we used to go with him. As young as 7 years, 5 years old, he would carry us on his shoulders. And I remember seeing elephants, wild elephants, in Chilla, Haridwar range. And my father would also keep animals at home. See, he would get snakes and keep them just to study them and other animals. So that's how the interest was there. So it was my father's idea, why don't you go to the film school and make films about these animals, which was a brilliant idea. I had no clue what the films are about, but his vision was such. And surprisingly, in Delhi, there were two film institute boys, one Parulkar, first batch, I think, and Patel.
Puranik Patel. Puranik Patel.
Puranik and Patel. Patel were different.
Correct. There were two people.
Two people. No, this was Parulkar. And Parulkar, I think, went for 2 years and left.
Okay.
But very bright fellow, very, very good person. And Patel was working with the German TV.
ARD.
So my father went and met both of them separately. Said, Naresh is interested. I want to send him to film school. What do you think? And both of them said, yes, why not? That's a very good institute. He would really learn. They gave their positive views. And this is how I appeared for the exam.
At FTI.
At FTI, I interview. Actually, that's a long story. Cut short the story. I was in Assam doing some photography. Nobody was at home, so I got a message that I had been called for interview, came all the way, flew for the first time in an airplane to attend this interview. And I was selected on the condition that my earlier exams will be cleared and all that sort of thing. Anyway, so that's how I got into the institute. But very important thing, I never went to the film school for the glamour of it. Like my other batchmates, like Balu Mahendran, Barun, they were all very clear. There are other few also, like Khan and all that. They were very clear. They had come to film the Bollywood beauties, you know. That's what the impression they had all the time.
And you was for the beast to film.
I said, no, I'm not interested. I want to make films about wildlife. I want to make documentaries. I want to be independent. And moreover, at that time, the institute boys were not well accepted in the industry. That was a time when they were still struggling. So, I think one very important point which I would like to make at this point. To me, I always considered Bollywood, I mean, the films, is a challenge, fine. It's a challenge of different kind. But everything is under your control.
True.
Actors are under your control. The lighting is under control. The whatever mood you want to give to the lighting. If the movements are not correct, you do it again, you do it 3 times, you do it 10 times to get your shot right. But that's again in comma, I would say, as directed by director, as directed by actors.
True.
So the role of a camera person as a cinematographer gets limited.
True.
And again, if the film is a big success, the credit goes to the director or to the actor. And once you look at the the credibility or the credits, the film, the cinematographers are...
It's in the rolling title.
In the rolling title. So that's where I thought, fine, I want to make a film, I want to make a documentary. Well, if the film is good, it's my credit. If the film is bad, even then I have the same responsibility. So this is how I thought. If Institute is good for training, I made full use of it. Staff was very supportive, very helpful. Even in my holiday time or whatever time, I would take a camera, experiment with it, learn about it. And I have been very extremely lucky with people in Film Institute. Technically, we learned a lot. But when it comes to the practical, I give you another example. I came back, my father said, "Arey, tum chutti mein aaye ho, take a camera and make something." अरे मैंने कहा पापा जी ऐसे फिल्म बनती है कोई पहले स्क्रिप्ट लिखनी पड़ेगी पहले ये करना पड़ेगा ये लिखना पड़ेगा उसके लिए बजट चाहिए अरे कहते छोड़ कुछ नहीं है सब यू वी बोरोड अ कैमरा फ्रॉम अ फ्रेंड पैलाड बोलेक्स कहना चलो जू चलते हैं तो चलो कहना कुछ बनाओ इसके ऊपर दैट्स माय इट वाज माय फादर हु पुश्ड मी एंड ही वाज सो ब्राइट यू नो इट्स अ चलो इनको लंच टाइम करके film banao tum. This was my second year. So we made a film with this Pelag Bolex going down the different enclosure and seeing different animals being fed, what fed. And then I came to coffee house and filmed all the people eating in coffee house and intercut it to make a 15-20 minutes film. And which was shown on Doordarshan. And it won some award in Asian broadcasting or something, you know. And that was how, see, you got a formal training, but in practical side, I think where we lacked at the institute training part of it. So field experience is completely different. So we learned, we started, we passed out. After passing out from Film Institute, winning gold medal for best student and best film and everything, I was offered a Marathi film, which I declined, and came to Delhi, back to Delhi, and started sort of freelancing. And the only channel at that time was Doordarshan, it just started, so it's working for them. And again, focusing on making short, soft stories for them, not hard news. I had to do hard news for them because that's what they needed at that time. But there was always in mind to make a good documentary film based on the wildlife. So, but what subject, what to make, where the money is, where the equipment is. So that was all the problems. So Rajesh, my brother, we got together. He was actually with the newspapers, working the Times of India, Statesman. He left his thing and we got together. And he had an assignment from National Geographic about the crocodilians, to film crocodiles. And that took years. Which at that time, there were only 300 surviving and no photographic record or no scientific study was there on their behavior. So Rajesh came back after a few trips to Risa, Chambal, this and that. And we sat together and said, oh, this is an animal we should be making a film about. Why? Because this is an Indian animal, not found anywhere else now. Maybe in Pakistan, which is again doubtful, and Nepal, that's the only area, and that's the fresh water, that's typical to India. And we should make a film. Make a film about an animal which are only 300 left and not even studied. Was a big challenge. So we decided to go ahead with this. Again the same problem. We had no equipment. But when Pelag Bolex liya, sauce of utke roll liye aur shuru kar diya, we started with it. Then you need a long lens, you need a tripod. And even getting a tripod was a huge problem. getting a smooth tripod.
Well maintained.
Not even, I mean, it was not possible. I mean, the only few news people who used to do, and to get them equipment from them was a big problem. I'll tell you why. It's good as long as you are friends. Once you start competing with one another, then the problem starts. They have a different attitude. Same Parulka, who advised my father that I should go to the film school. My father went to him, Naresh has passed out this and this, now he wants to do something. Can you help him to get some contacts and all that? So he told very clearly to my father, now Naresh is in the field. He would be competing against me. So it's better you don't take my advice. Let him do struggle whatever way he wants to. So that was very clear. So I don't blame him, but he was very frank and open. But there are other people who will never give you equipment. First they will ask you for whom you are working, how long you are working, how much are you charging, all sorts of questions just to discourage you. So I have gone through that exercise. I had an assignment to film Siberian Cranes in Bharatpur. They come in winters. They used to come in winter, but now many years they are not coming. So that was that was the best.
But what is the reason they are not coming now?
I think this is the change of habitat. Changes. Nobody actually knows the actual reason. But it's the habitat or the disturbance in Afghanistan and Pakistan, because that's the route they used to take as a migration route. But what has happened to that population which used to come here, nobody knows. But they're still trying to find out. Now to film that one particular sequence, I'm telling you how difficult it was. Because these birds' activity starts very early, right into the water. So one has to go wade into the water at 4 o'clock before the sunrise, before it's even light, make a hide in water, and you have to wade through this much water so that you can get some closer shots of these animals. So you have to make a hide, but to get equipment first. Tripod pehle nahi dega koi aapko. Achha, kal jana hai haath mein na, to aap aisa karo ki raat ko 11 baje le jana. So I had to take my father on my scooter to get bloody this tripod at winter at this place, 11 o'clock, and so early morning, 4 o'clock, we had to leave. Then you wade through the water, sit in a hide, freezing cold, you are shivering, and you have these birds all around you to film. Well, that was a lifetime achievement. I mean, now that thing is over. The footage, unfortunately, is all with the BBC because we filmed it for BBC. It's a history. So this is how we started into going back to Ghadiyals. It went on for 5 years. We filmed in Corbett. I was sitting in Corbett. Nihai Rajesh was sitting across in a different hide. And there was a tiger just behind me. And without any arms or anything. So Rajesh pointed out to me, look back, because all these lagoons were making noise. And they were very close, tiger walking. So I had to turn back, just look in case it comes, only thing I have is a battery which I can throw at the tiger. Or jump into the river right in front of me, where the ghadiyals and magars are there. But luckily nothing happened. Similarly, while filming in Chambal, because Chambal had a major population of ghadiyals, and there was this banded queen at that time operating. All these dacoits were there. I mean, every day you will meet some people who say, "Arey, aapki ghadi, how much does it cost? How much this box cost? Arey, ye camera kitne ka hai?" So their mentality of those people is such. Everything they evaluate in terms of money. And how much money they can extract from this person by kidnapping. So that was the situation we were living. And I mean, there's another incident where our researcher was, his binoculars were taken by Poonam Devi and all that. There were sadhus bathing in front of us, who were crossing the temple, and they were so scared of, I mean, jaldi chalo kahin Poonam Devi na aa jaye. I mean, they were absolutely terror. And we worked, we stayed, we slept. Number of days, months in Chambal. For what? For Garyat. Just for Garyat. People used to say, you are mad. In fact, one day, the local superintendent of police came. He said, oh, Mr. Devi, you are camping here. You have not even informed the police. Once you are kidnapped, how are we going to save you? We cannot save you. So better wind up, go to some place which is more safer. In a village or safer at least. So these are the practical problems which we face. But then there were technical problems which we face.
Yeah. For example, just elaborate that.
For example, we wanted to film nesting behavior in Chambal. Now the light, how to get the light? So what we did, almost 1 kilometer, more than 1 kilometer, we put poles and brought light and put it on dimmer. And every day we used to put the dimmer on, slowly bring the light so that the animal get used to our lighting. So in case when we use it, or when the mother comes to open the nest, so we'll be able to film, so they get used to it. But that, we tried for a year, it didn't work because the load was so low, you know, sometimes the light will come, sometimes the light will not come at the right moment. But we did that experiment. With the wildlife, you have to be very lucky also.
But again, taking it further, little lighting situations. Could you just tell then, how did you manage after 1 year that since it was not working, so what was the solution found for it, for lighting up?
No, finally we managed with the lighting only, and the only way was to acclimatize the animal to our lighting, which would come every day. So they knew that there is something which will come up without disturbing them.
Getting them accustomed to the whole thing.
Yes, it took a long time to do it. The second year when we missed altogether, because the right at the moment when the female was coming, there was a leopard calling very close by, and the big storm came and the rain came, so we had to move out to the village to protect our cameras. But I could not sleep, I was awake. As soon as the rain stopped, I came, which was about 5 o'clock in the morning, hardly any light, you know. And what I see, the nest is already open, the gharial is on the bank, and the hatchlings are moving out. I said, my God, the whole 1 year is wasted. But we managed to get some shots, but not the actual process, which we managed to do it, I think, the fourth year. That was the key sequence. Because not many people knew, not even the scientists knew, or the biologist knew, ki what role gharial has with a long snout. Like other crocodilians, they carry their young in their mouth to the water. But here gharial cannot because of the long snout with 108 teeth. And the eyes are above. So how he sees, looks at the nest. So that was a mystery. Ki whether the hatchling climb on them and then they move down or whatever. But that we could solve and film. The female comes and open the nest wide open, not the narrow digging, it's wide open so that they can climb out themselves. And she would be there watching them throughout unless the last egg is hatched. So that was one thing, and she does not carry them in their mouth as other crocodilian. Again, like the mating sequence, the male has a hump, which, again, there was a mystery why this hump is there, you know. One biologist said ki it helps them to hold the female. Well, that's actually written in his report. And when we filmed it, it's not true. The the pitcher-like structure, the ghada, is there to resound sound. So his nasal sound is amplified. And he makes this bubbling sound like an engine, you know, steam engine sound. So that's the function which we were able to capture and record, both film and sound, which made a lot of difference. And it's a khyal that I showed this material to some broadcaster abroad, you know. Oh, they were very excited. Oh, we have never seen such an animal. I've never seen such a behavior. I said, but can you get some underwater? Underwater? What do you mean by underwater? And it was a challenge. I said, fine, we'll try and we'll do something. First of all, when I started with the first sequence, showed them material, they said, it's very good, but can you get them eating fish? I said, yes, certainly we can. Because nobody believed us as Indians who could deliver the thing. That was very important. Wherever you went, I went to the BBC, Natural History Unit. They got all my first material without paying anything. I mean, that's something which young filmmakers should be very careful in getting negotiations, you know. You get trapped. Like, all my Chambal material, which took months and months to get, they said, oh, no, don't worry. I didn't have money to even pay for processing in abroad. So they said, no, we'll get it processed. So they paid for the processing and returned, they kept the material. They said, no, we paid for it. We did this and without paying anything to me. And they're still using that material. So the filmmaker has to be very smart, you know, and understand this big people, broadcaster, how they can corner it, you know.
True. Since this was a landmark film, Then you move to various other films.
Let me complete quickly this one.
Yeah.
So finally we designed our own underwater.
True.
With some still camera remotes and all that.
Correct.
So it worked. We got some shots which are in the film.
But they were used with the still cameras. And what about the housing and all that?
No, we created housing. We made our own housing. We used camera, but to trigger that camera, we had to use some remotes, still camera remote and all the experimented. Finally, we were able to get few good enough shots to be incorporated in the film. Finally, the film was to be edited. So the film was edited in Germany and had a terrible time with the German editor. Terrible time. Because she thought people coming from India doesn't know anything. So she can tell me what the editing is. But I knew much more than her experience of wildlife films. She wanted to cut every movement of the ghadiyals, you know, with the next movement. You know, it doesn't work. The ghadiyal is a slow animal. He will come, wait, slowly move around, change his position. If you cut everything, go fast. And that was my original material. And she wanted to cut. I said, no way. So we had a big fight. Finally, the film was complete. And the good thing is, it was shown, it was submitted.
But this is also important because what you mentioned right now, the cut, because editor always think in terms of cut, and these are the movement are very slow, animals are very slow, they are least bothered about the cut. So this, what kind of editing pattern has to be adopted?
It's according to the animal. You have to give time. See, it's not a chase sequence. They are coming out slowly, looking around, so you have to build up accordingly. So that was a sequence, I mean, the number of sequence, ghadiyal is a slow animal. So it has to be, the pace has to be slower. You cannot make everything. It's not a tiger chasing an animal or cheetah chasing something where you can have the fast cutting, which I understood very well. And another thing, the trend was every sequence has to develop. People like to watch and see what is happening. You cannot rush and dramatize everything which is happening now in the films. Even the wildlife films, there's a story. I mean, there's certain things which we were not supposed to do at that time are now being done unnecessarily just to get the TRP.
Create a kind of a suspense.
Suspense, unnecessary suspense. All these tigers films and all that. I mean, unnatural, I would call them. anyway, so that film was submitted to this Wild Screen, which was most popular, still among the best wildlife filming. And that was my first experience in any film festival, and everybody had full of praise about this film. And finally the film was judged. I got the Best Cinematography Award for Wildlife, which is a big thing, competing against
big wigs,
big guns from all over the world. So I think that was my Oscar at that time. That gave me big courage. I said, what? This is what I was aiming for. I mean, that's what the recognition is of your work. So I think Gharyaal is a very important film. Another thing I would like to add, even till today, there's not a second film which has covered Gharyaal behavior in that much detail. Nobody has been able to film again second time the nesting, the other behaviors. So that's the achievement. It took 5 years. As a film, as a cinematographer, as a director, that was a big thing for me. And not big thing for only for me, I think a big thing for India.
True.
It was the first Indian film going abroad and making headlines.
True. Okay.
So that's about the
moving from Gharyaal to elephants. The Lord of Jungle Elephant is another film which is quite talked about, Channel 4 in UK, like the various international network shown that particular film. So tell us something about now Elephant, which is very respected in India, has its own myth and also has its own problems in terms of they are also getting extinct now. So tell us about this film, what you aimed at in this particular film.
See, after Gharyaal, we moved on to two films actually, The Tigers and The Elephants. Tigers was important because the Tiger Project was launched and tigers were in big news. And we have been associated with tigers earlier, and we had filmed launching of Project Tiger and all that. So, tigers were, I'll go to tigers
first,
and then
first
we
finish with tigers.
Because the tiger, right, filming tigers has a different, see every animal when you film or look at it, or endangered animal or animal, you have to understand them well. You have to understand their behavior, their movements, their areas. So you have to do a little bit of research to understand. And that you can do by reading various papers, meeting different people, and also the locals, which have extremely good knowledge.
Elaborate that again, the research part. I mean, when you were going for a film like on Tiger, how did you go over the research first?
See, for research is, I think it's very important to get whatever people have worked, to meet them first, get interview for them, get whatever their observations are, read whatever they have written about. Just to give you an example, we wanted to make a film about red pandas, and that what happened, I read a news item in a paper that two red pandas being released into the nature. I said, that's a film, one should capture, follow these two red pandas going into the field. Because they will be collared, so you can track them.
True.
And then through them, you make a whole film, how they adopt to nature and what happens. So this is what the research part of it. Not only that. So who are the people who have done research? So there was only one woman who had done research. So I went and met him in Darjeeling, Dr. Pradhan. And my first question was to her, make a Dr. Pradhan, tell me, you have studied them in nature. Tell me, how many times have you seen a wild panda? And her answer was shocking. He said, for first 6 months, I did not see any thunder. It's only after 6 months I saw my first panda, and I was so thrilled to see one. I said, 6 months तो काम ही नहीं कर सकते. 6 months तक तो आप कैमरा उठा उठा के पहाड़ों में ऊपर नीचे जाते हो. So that's kind of a difficulty. So you are mentally prepared. That kind of a challenge you have. Then she said there was a British team who came to film. They stayed for here for 2 weeks. They couldn't find a single animal, so they went back. So that's another very depressing and discouraging. But once you decide, I mean, that's has been with me, you know, any challenging project which involves more of a challenge, I accept. Rather than doing a routine, normal, usual thing. So for Tiger, we did research. We pinpointed the area. For example, there were, Kana was a good area at that time in the Tiger project, where the Tiger was reasonably good. People were good, very supportive. And we started work on it. But then the problem in Kana, every reserve has a different thing to see, you know. I mean, for example, Kana and Corbett or this place is, you go by elephants.
True.
Like Ranthambore, where you have jeeps now. You can watch them by jeeps. So they are, Kana, mostly you go by, you can see, go by jeep, and if you're lucky you can see, but for filming point of view, you have to spend time with tigers. It's not something which you can film just by tiger passing shot. So you go on elephant, look for this tiger, and then try to spend whole day with it. That was our
basic agenda,
basic
mindset,
working plan. Now, we started doing this, but the first immediate problem was to how to get your steady shots. Elephant is always moving, you cannot zoom in and take a shot, it's going like this. So we had to design what we called it our elephant tripod. It was just 3 legs, almost the height of elephant, so you put it down and shoot from the elephant. But then later on we found that it's not that effective, because once you're an elephant, you're holding on to the viewfinder. At the right moment, if the tiger moves, the elephant reacts and your head is off and you cannot follow it. That's a practical problem. So you have to be looking at the eyepiece, your eyepiece. Or if you move your head, the light will enter and fog the film. That also happens. So you have to be close, which is not possible with this tripod and you both separated. Then later we designed a seat on the tripod. So where from elephant I would move on to the tripod, which was very risky. Getting on to the tripod and then sitting on to the tripod, keeping the elephant side. So that worked. And that's how we were able to get extreme good behavioral shots and good close-up shots, which was very effective, and which lot of people after us adopted that and were able to make films, and that became a very essential part of any kind of film shot in those areas, Bandhavgarh or Kana. Again, there were very interesting stories about that, filming tigers, for example.
Yeah. Please carry on.
It's something which you have to understand. You have to understand the behavior. Just to give you a very small example. One day I was on the elephant. I got information the tigress had given birth to the cubs. And that tigress in our area where we were working. So we were concentrating in one area, following one tigress for almost 2 years. So this was monsoon time when the park is closed. So we were given special permission and we went there. Looking for 5-10 days passed. Nothing, no sign of the tigress or cubs. So one day we found the cubs on the hill in the open, just lying. There was no mother. So what I did was immediately I said, okay, after looking around, we just put the tripod down on the rocks. It was very shaky, it was not a very good place to put a tripod. I said, I put it between these two bamboo bush, I can get a view, so let's try and put it. I put the tripod. There was nobody else. There were three elephants, my three elephants. I moved them back. I said, I just keep a watch what happens. I was there waiting for almost 2 hours. And then I heard the female coming. She was making sound for the cubs. She came. It was not more than 20 feet from my tripod, down like this. But this is where your experience comes, you know. You have to be, don't get excited. Don't get over enthusiastic. This is what is very important role in my life, or any filmmaking, I would say. You have to keep detached with the surroundings. Rights ho rahe, kuch ho rahe, you get detached. If you get involved, your minds get involved into it.
Gone.
So I was very cool. I was almost shivering. You know, my legs were shivering. My hand on a trigger, looking through the viewfinder, watching each movement of the tigress. She came, she looked at me, she whispered, again looked at me. I did not move. I did not even switch on my camera, knowing I must give her enough time that there is no danger from me. There is enough confidence. She came, she lifted the cup in front of me. I started the camera. As she was looking down, she moved the cub in his mouth, lifted up, looked at me, as if saying, Naresh, shoot as much as you want. That was my dream shot. I always wanted a shot at tigress with a cub in her mouth. And she looked at me, whispering and holding it. She turned right, she turned left, holding it.
Like and acting for you.
Acting for me. And that too is a young cub. I mean, hardly 10 days old, eyes are just open, you know. So that, sometimes, after doing that, she
put it back.
Put it back.
Because she knew the shot is taken.
Shot is taken. Shot is taken. Not only that, she lies down there in front of the camera, right in a small gap where I can film.
Give me the dream shot to you.
And all this four cubs suckling. And she has closed eyes, she is looking at me. Thodi der baad khol ke dekh legi, safe hai. But I was not making any. I changed the magazine, even changing the magazine, katak sound, maine kaha ye bhag jayegi. Or she can ground, I mean, she can come straight at me.
Yeah.
In one pound, she will be at me.
True.
So that danger was there. Kego se itna sa bhi yo kiya, my tripod will fall because it was not a steady ground. So I filmed that whole sequence of suckling, then the baby went to sleep. She carried them one by one into another area. Excellent sequence. I mean, that's only possible through our elephant tripod and understanding of the animal.
True.
It's both things combined.
Now.
And then this film again won many awards, see, and it won the National Geographic Award and Best Kodak Award for filming tigers. And both these tiger films were nominated for British Academy Awards in 1987, which is the most prestigious, again, awards. So that was it. I mean, that's something which I cannot forget. I mean, you see all these big awards now.
True.
I mean, this is where first time I had to wear a
bow tie.
Yes.
Wildlife cinematographer wearing a bow tie.
It was very strange, but it was an experience.
True. Now moving to elephant.
Yes, yes, elephants is a different ball game altogether, filming elephants. For which we filmed in South India, we filmed in Karnataka and Corbett in Shivalik and other places. But again, the key sequences for any wildlife film or blue chip film, what you call, is some rare behavior. For example, in tiger, we got the mating, we got the cubs, we got even the leopard, one cub dying in the film, which we rescued, and even this the tigress which we were following killed a leopard, which was, I think, the first and last till today. Nobody has been able to photograph again, but we had the whole sequence in the film, the tigress feeding on a leopard. With the elephants, we were looking for some dramatic, interesting sequences to make a film interesting. For example, elephant sleeping sequence. But how do the elephants sleep? How the young ones lie down, or they stand and sleep? So that was quite challenging, because the elephants are very sensitive about smell, very sensitive about the sight is not very good, the eyesight is poor, sound is good. So when they sleep, they go into deep in the forest and look for a big tree and they sleep under that normally. That's what they do. And now to reach at that spot,
to their bedroom actually.
Bedroom was most difficult. But we tried different ways. Suddenly what will happen, you know, you go, they are sleeping, you go quietly, you put your tripod, everything is ready. You start filming, suddenly the wind changes, you know.
So they wake up.
And they wake up, they charge. So these are the, and the getting a proper angle, once you are there on the ground, you need to have a higher angle to get their shots because of the vegetation. So you have to look for a spot which is favorable for filming, higher and safe enough in case they charge you, run away. But we managed to get finally some good shots of them standing, the big elephants lying down on the ground, and they get up, how they get up. It was all very interesting, especially keeping the calves in between their group. That was one thing. And then another sequence which was most challenging, I wanted to film the birth of an elephant. It was not possible in nature. So we thought we should do it with the domestic elephant. So we knew there's a domestic pregnant elephant in Bandipur, and in the camp, elephant camp. So we started following that. So the elephant pregnancy, you cannot be sure, you know, and it's such a big stomach, you will never know. So practically we started spending months. You know, once a phone comes, "Arey, aajao, abhi hone wala." So you fly to Bangalore and drive to Bandipur, and you are camping there. Nothing to do all day, you know, just watch any sight. "Arey, kuch ho raha hai?" "Nahi, kuch nahi." Then technically we had a lot of problems with the battery. We had a camera problem, so we had to get some car battery to run our camera, you know, and one man will carry the battery. And one day we did come to know about the natural birth, but all these females were charging from different directions and will not allow anybody to go closer, so it was impossible to film. But we could film the calf the next day. But this thing, what happened in the evening, they said, the female is about to give a birth. So we were quite close, so we were there, and she was kicking off the dust behind, you know, and with the feet, and finally it delivered. Then what an unfortunate thing. The calf was stillborn. So what can you do? After months of following an animal, just to get a right shot of delivery and his behavior, she delivers a stillborn calf. It's tragic. But that doesn't. So that's are the challenges of wildlife, real wildlife filmmaking. So you aim something, it doesn't happen. Then there was another very interesting sequence where This was the time when the Veerappan, the famous sandalwood cutter and elephant tusk hunter, was operating in that area. I know going into the forest, people will say, no, 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 we don't go in this area. Please, we will not go with you. Because I had seen his camp where some fresh meat was lying and all that, and they will shoot you, sir. Don't go. So we had that kind of a fear also in that area. And in fact, we had seen two elephants with bullet marks in their head, which we informed the forest department when they caught, and we got a lovely sequence of that, how this elephant was caught and treated, but unfortunately could not be saved, very young tusker. So the poaching was a huge problem. We were able to film a big tusker with a cross tusk like this, you know, and he had a bullet mark here, and to film the whole sequence is agony in water. I mean, it's so tragic. He was in real pain when touch his wound, bullet wound mark, you know, with his trunk, you know, put mud, lie down in the mud. But finally, he was finished in another 2 weeks.
Coming back to the two films you have made on the Ladakh. So, can you elaborate, because you are working in a region which is a high altitude region, a lot of problem in terms of breathing first, and also a religion problem because the monks are there, so people become very conscious what you are doing and what you are aiming at and all that. So, can you briefly tell us about that?
Again, Ladakh we took up because there was hardly any work in Ladakh, hardly any work. And totally unexplored area, and only some army officials had taken some pictures, and I would certainly say that Mr. General Gore, who had done some photography in that area, was posted, was a sort of a source of inspiration for us. Once we saw these pictures, he said, certainly we can do a good film there. And as a research, he was the first point of research, and he guided us how to go about it. Moreover, the area where we were working, that was very close to the Chinese border. So it was all, I'm talking about early 90s and so on, when it was still very sensitive. And even Indians were not allowed with special permission. The army camps were there, all along the border. So we had to make our own arrangement with consultation with this. We had a liaison officer, the army liaison officer deputed with us to film. So that kind of all the formalities we had to go through. It is a very difficult terrain. Vast area with very little population. So we were given a lot of instruction before. And if you're traveling in a car or by a jeep, in the car means when you're a four-wheel drive, take enough ration with you. Take enough thing to eat in case you are stuck. You're stuck. And there won't be any help, immediate help, because there's no system of communication. And you will freeze to death. So those kind of things, you know, you mentally prepared for. And it was a difficult. I mean, I was not keeping too well because of my allergic asthma I had. And that's very bad for that area. And
somebody who has asthma is going to Ladakh.
Ladakh, with the thin air, very little oxygen. Climbing, I mean, even now I would say, before you go to further into Ladakh, you have to go fly to Leh and acclimatize for 4 days.
True.
I mean, that's a normal thing.
True.
And we were working right at 16,000 feet or even above, you know, which is pretty difficult. And not only that, we decided to film in winters with minus 35 degrees, which was even more challenging. So I had to get all the winter clothing from UK. So I got special friends who were there who suggested, no, no, take this thermal, take this jacket, take this. So all the equipment I got for this filming. from UK. Then there was a challenge of filming, getting the material, you know. So our aim was to focus on this lake, which is the Somarari Lake, is 16,000 feet, because the barred geese come and breed. That's the only known breeding ground in India, mainly. So that was our target. So first was to locate where the island is, where they come and breed. And one has to reach before the birds arrive. That's before the lake melts, because it gets all frozen. So that was the major challenge. So one winter we tried driving through the snow. There was no road. We had to take army help, crossing this streams with almost, you know, your vehicle going into the snow. And often get your vehicle stuck on the snow. But finally, we managed to reach. But even then, the birds had arrived. So we had to locate. And there are a number of stories. I so cut short the story. I would say we saw this whole lake melting in front of us, all this crackling sound of the snow. And that time we had taken our boat, which we tried to use, inflatable boat. And that was the first time anybody had done that in this lake. Because everybody thought there's a big monster living in that, you know, it'll eat you up and all that.
What is the name of this film?
The Forbidden Wilderness. And the very interesting, I think the, if you ask me what was your most memorable events of filming, so one of them was here when we were almost dead.
Because of the weather?
No, I took the boat to check on the other side. It's a 20 kilometers lake. And not knowing much experience, not knowing enough of the area, so I ventured in. It was all snow blocks, so I was moving through the snow. By the time I reached the other end, it was almost evening. And there were no birds breeding there. So I had to start back without realizing how long it will take. Without realizing the winds pick up in the evening and the lake becomes a sea, almost sea, with the big waves coming. So my small dinghy was all the time thrown out, you know, thrown back out of the water, you know, it was almost lifted and thrown. So the engine will stop and it's freezing, I mean, it's all ice. So my hands got blue, equipment in front got all watered. पानी भर गया उसमें द एक असिस्टेंट जो था देख लें सर हमें तो बाहर कर दो आप किस तरह जस्ट लीव अस आई सर आई कैन नॉट गो टू द शोर कैन आई गो टू शोर द विंड इज कमिंग दिस साइड इज थ्रोइंग दिस वे एंड द सेम डे द बैड लक राजेश वाज ऑन ए आइलैंड वी लेफ्ट हिम इन द हाइट एंड ही कुड नॉट कम आउट सो व्हाट ही डिड ही वेडेड दिस थ्रू दिस मच वाटर टू द बैंक with the camera holding in his hand. He could have been dead. And, I mean, it's all marsh. So it gets stuck and it's freezing and he will freeze to death. So the whole village where we had camped was there. Kisi wo aaye nahi kaha chale gaye kehna unko to monster kha gaya nahi hai. So Rajesh in the evening saw some body floating on the lake. He said, ek to gaya. I'm not sure. The whole village there.
And whose body was it?
That was some. They have a tradition of throwing the body, they call the Buddhists. Either they leave it on the hilltop or they throw it into the water. But in the evening, somehow. I knew where I had to go. I knew the hill under which our camp is. So I was trying and forcing myself. Barambar start karke usko maine kaha himmat nahi aayi. At that time I prayed to God. I don't believe in gods, but at that was the only day when I prayed. And I said, Bhagwan, bacha lo aaj to aap. So finally, somehow pushing, unko kaho bhai pani thoda thoda phenkte jao bahar, unke hands were so cold, they could not. Even the locals, मैं तो थ्रॉटल पे चला रहा था उसको, तो भाई है somehow at about 7:38 Rajesh and Party, they saw some light because I had a small flashlight which I flashed from a distance. They said, oh, there's some hope, somebody coming. And Rajesh was so excited to see how many people are there on the boat, two or three or one. So that was such a scary moment of life. So I landed at about 8 o'clock at our campsite with all feet and hands blue. दो तीन कैमरा जो थे वो चले गए. इवन माई एरी एस आर वॉज डाउन विद वॉटर. लकीली आई हैड अ सेकेंड बैकअप कैमरा विच वी कंटिन्यू टू वर्क एंड वी सर्वाइव्ड एंड मेड अ फिल्म अबाउट द लाइफ साइकिल ऑफ द बारहेडेड गीस विच वॉज फर्स्ट टाइम इन द वर्ल्ड एनीवेयर बिकॉज दे ब्रीड इन साइबेरिया. द बीबीसी कुड फिल्म इट द नेक्स्ट ईयर in Siberia, but we did it first in India. The whole life cycle, the various behavior which they were interpreting in different ways, but we felt the whole life cycle for the first time. So that was about the breeding cycle of Barenaked. But then we had a similar instance. We were very keen to get this snow leopard because snow leopard was the climax for the film, to get at least one shot of the snow leopard. Very, very difficult to film.
For the same film?
So the same film. Three winters, no luck. We see fresh pug marks, we see everything, but no sign of. And climbing those mountains, going through this, and staying, food, everything is frozen. You take anda, ball ki tarah, patthar ki tarah, pheko to bhi nahi tootega. Onion gets solid. Potato gets solid, you know. So, food, you don't get taste, it's all canned food. So you have to survive. But you have to do, I mean, you have to camp. We did all that. It very, very difficult. Again, the cameras don't work.
Yeah, batteries.
Batteries don't work. We had solar charges still. The battery, I got these cameras specially degreased.
Just to tell us about the solar charges. What is the solar charges?
See,
chargers.
Yes, you have a smaller solar panel, which nowadays is very easily available, by which you can plug in your battery, because the sunlight is there, there's not a problem. So you, that charges your batteries. So at least we could charge our batteries. But the problem was, the main problem in winter filming, is the cameras are greased, all the things are, which gets
stuck.
Jam jati hai wo. To uske liye kya hota hai ki, I mean, that was specially done by Airy people. They will degrease, take out all the grease and put some new, different grease which doesn't freeze. So either degrease it or grease it with a proper unfreezable grease. So I even got that camera degreased from the company to work in. But snow leopard is snow leopard. I mean, we were, it's extremely difficult. But finally we were able to film, see at least two, three snow leopards in the wild. And Rajesh got a very good sequence. I was not there on that trip. Rajesh got a news that snow leopard had killed a yak, young yak. And killed. So he tracked almost whole day to reach that valley.
Who killed that?
Snow leopard had killed.
Okay.
So the immediate instruction we had sent, please don't touch that. We had already told these people, don't touch that, don't take, because what happens is when the snow leopard kills a yak, for example, they will drive away. I mean, the snow leopard will leave the kill as soon as he sees the people. They will take back the yak to eat themselves. So we had told them, okay, we'll compensate you for that. So Rajesh went and put up a hide. And no wonder, the snow leopard came the same way where the hide was. Snow leopard was standing about 10 feet, 5 feet away from Rajesh's hide, not knowing that somebody is sitting, because he was focusing on his kill. So he went there, filmed at the sunset. So he could hardly get few hundred feet of footage of him dragging and eating in the snow, which was unique. So there are difficulties, there are the problem is you get disheartened when there's no work, what to do. I mean, all day waiting, nothing happening, not even taking a shop. So that...
You have patience.
You run out of patience. But I've got an interest here. You keep on, you are determined to do certain things, and nothing that happens.
The one which I would also like you to talk about is the series of this film called Wild Adventure
Billionaire Brothers. Yeah, it's very interesting.
Because now you are entering into the sky. From water, underwater, jungles, now it's the sky.
See, it's very interesting. I got an assignment. I mean, this is every film has some story to tell, you know, how you start, pick up your subject, you know. It's not something which you always plan and do it. So it's something, sometimes it happens. There was this, if you remember, there was a big move about declaring Taj Mahal as Seven Wonders.
True.
By this Swiss person, I don't remember his name. So he came to Taj to promote this big launch of his campaign. And for that he called Aishwarya to be in the balloon. And they had a balloon. Then Aishwarya was so scared of going into the balloon. She said, no, I'll not go into the balloon. But she came and participated in that for this cause, because of Taj Mahal. So for that he had brought his balloon. It's just during that we thought, why not do a series with a balloon, you know? That's where the idea came. So we wrote up the idea that why not have this wild wilderness areas through balloon, which nobody has done in India, and probably will not be able to do because of now rules and regulations. The Forest Department does not allow a balloon flying over any reserve forest or national parks. Because this was a project for government, for Doordarshan, and we happily did it because the Doordarshan, as you know, doesn't pay much, but we did it because we wanted to do it. It was a fun, it was an adventure which we wanted to take. It was exciting, very exciting. I mean, covering 30 locations, carrying about 30-40 people of balloon team, and going into a uncertainty. You fly in a balloon in an area, you don't know where you're going to land, what you're going to get, where the wind will take you, whether you will have a crash landing or whether you will be able to land properly. These were challenges which we accepted. And it was fun, real fun. Every day there's another something new. We had spent weeks getting the right direction for filming, or flying at least, because like Bandhavgarh, for example, I wanted to fly over a main hill which has temples and which has big reservoirs the whole time, fly over it. But to get that right wind which will take you across that hill was very difficult. So we spent about a week just going round every day, you know. I try karke dekhte, band kar diya. Finally we were able to fly. And it's not only question, I think I must give credit to the pilot. It was a British pilot who could do it. And he was very interested. Like for example, we flew in Corbett Park. A small flight going right up to 4,000 feet and down, because the wind was not in favoring us. So we were going against the wind, we were going into the area where the balloon will not be retrievable. वो तो पहाड़ों में चला जाएगा, वहां को ना रास्ता है ना जंगल है, हाथियों के बीच में कहाँ पे गिर जाएंगे, पेड़ पे टंग जाएंगे, कुछ पता नहीं. सो ही रियली मैनूवर इट एंड लकीली वी लैंडेड राइट एट द रेस्ट हाउस एंड जस्ट बिलो द रेस्ट हाउस वी मैनेज टू लैंड. उसके बाद मैंने कहा हाउ बिल वर्क, व्हाट डू यू थिंक, हाउ वाज योर फ्लाइट, कांग्रेचुलेशंस, आई हैव डन इट. And I can guarantee you, not many people will venture this kind of balloon.
Because you never know tomorrow you will be able to take a flight or not.
Whether you will be alive or not, because you don't know where you land up. And that's a huge forested area. And there's no road, nothing in some areas.
But shooting from top, you know, because there's always a jerk in terms of because of the air, also because of the engine which is floating the stuff. How difficult it was to have a steady shot.
That's it.
And was it on a film format or was it on a video?
It was on video format. Okay. And in fact, we used 3-4 cameras. One was fixed camera on the thing. I was using handheld because putting it on a tripod, I thought it was not. I didn't like it because it does not absorb many jerks. As if you are on a shoulder, your body will absorb and you will can adjust according to the bumps which you get in the balloon. And moreover, carrying another tripod, it's a small area. You cannot have many equipment. So you have
how many people can stand in that area?
We were all the time 4 people, pilot plus 2 of us, 3 of us actually. So we were using 2 cameras at a time, plus wherever, most of the places we had a third camera following from the ground. So he could follow wherever our balloon was going, but not always possible. But getting a shot, getting a perspective from the top is amazing. The kind of shot you get a very good smooth shot if your balloon is flowing. If the balloon is sturdy, there's no wind, then it's a problem. The only shot you can get is a revolving shot. The balloon, you can ask the pilot to revolve the balloon. So you get all 380 degree shot, which is again very useful at some places, which we used.
Kind of panoramic.
Like a panoramic shot. Like, we had a lot of fun at different places and a lot of difficulties. In Chambal, for example, I mean, that was a bad day. I mean, we went into the Chambal, we had wrecked the area and everything. Then our vehicle got stuck, so we had to start at one particular place because we had no time left, because we had 2 days. And when we flew, there was no wind, absolutely no wind. So we were just circling around in one area without doing much.
And what was this series about in terms of, because it was a series, so it was not one theme only. So what was the various subjects which you wanted to film in this series?
See, it's the...
But it's not just ballooning, it is a
no,
subject
I think
also.
The important thing was the storyline. Storyline, Bedi brothers' adventure into different areas. So through our adventure, through the ballooning sport, we were trying to convey a story of conservation, story of the problem, story of the area. So the only area you can show is through the balloon. You go down, you land, you talk to the people. What their feelings are. आप क्या कर रहे हो ऊपर, अरे क्या कर रहे हैं भैया, घूम रहे, देख रहे हैं यहाँ पे जानवर कैसे. एंड देन यू हैव आर्गुमेंट, यू टॉक टू दीज पीपल, अरे आप जितना घड़ियाल यहाँ से ले जाओ, हमारा तो वो जानवर भी नहीं जाने देते पानी पीने के लिए. यू दे आर वेरी एंग्री, दे वॉन्ट सम सेफ्टी, दे वॉन्ट सम, सो यू हैव टू एक्सप्लेन टू देम, अरे भैया अगर घड़ियाल मर जाएंगे यहाँ पे तो आप पानी कहाँ से पियोगे, पानी भी दूषित हो जाएगा. सो यू हैव टू इंटरेक्ट विद देम. Try and explain them the importance
because
of
Ghariyal, the water is...
Ghariyal, because of the Ghariyal, you are able to drink this water. Because they are...
It is your oxygen.
वो दिखा रहे हैं कि they can survive. If they start dying, that means the water is so polluted. तो मैंने कहा ये सब बातें समझ ली. हाँ, आपकी दिक्कतें हैं, आपके there all these animal come and raid your crops. Why the government should do something about it. So it was more of... a conservation driven, more awareness driven series where people not only looking at the ballooning, these Bedi brothers looking and talking about the problems, talking about the conservation issues, talking about the habitat, talking about the wildlife of this particular area wherever we went. For example, we went in Saliska where the tiger was wiped out, we flew in Corbett, we flew in Chambal, we flew in Madhya Pradesh, where the bear problem, the bears are being has a huge problem because of the deforestation. The people are cutting, they have cleared the whole hills where the bears have their dens. We have the near Kaziranga, the rhinos area, we flew, I mean, and it was very interesting flying over the rhino area. The rhino was challenging our balloon, you know. He thought, who the hell this fellow has come in our territory, in my territory. He was coming and almost looking at us, charging and urinating, as showing his anger. So it was very interesting. See, it's a very different perspective, but I mean, of course, we had a lot of crash landing where we thought we had enough. Arey aisa nahi hona chahiye. All our equipment got full of dust and luckily nothing broke except some still lenses damaged. Because when it lands, you know, the theory is the more stronger the bang is of the basket to the ground, it stops. The balloon
comes down
immediately. So it has to come lower down, lower, 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 and finally hit the ground. And that's the time you have to take care of your equipment. And that's where the pilot will tell you, you know, going to take your position. So you have to bend down, head down, closing your equipment. And one day Ajay was taking a shot. Ajay, you are going to fall. You go out of basket. You know, with the jump, you may be thrown out. So you have to stick, hold on. It was fun. All this landing, all the aerial shots, for example, in Velamada, you have all these black bucks from there. Fantastic.
Moving further to film on sadhus. Many people have done it, but your film is always remembered as unique in terms of many things. So tell us a little bit about the sadhus film.
I think after the passing out from the Film Institute, I got some film stock as given to me, and that time this Kumbh Mela was coming, which must be in 78 or something. So I filmed whatever 10-15 rolls of Kodak roll, 100 feet rolls I had on the Kumbh Mela. And I showed it to one of the BBC executive producers. And he was so excited, he said, such a wonderful material, why don't you make a film out of it? I said, fine, I would love to provide you, I have some money, because coming out from the institute like raw, and we had nothing. So he said, no, we BBC can give you some money, and we can even invite you to UK to edit this film. Well, I said, no, that's good. So we developed that film into a proper film, 60-minute film, where we showed initiation of sadhus, how the sadhus are made, the basic sense, where they are taught, where their ashrams are in Rishikesh, how they practice yoga and all that. I mean, there's more about the sadhu organizations, not only the freak sadhus doing funny things. So that was my first film, very first film after the institute, and that I edited in UK with a BBC editor. And that was a big learning experience. I learned a lot. The whole technique of filmmaking. How the tracks are laid, how the films are cut, how the clips are numbered, everything. How they are locked, how the mixing tracks are made, overlapping each other, which is not, this is not good sound, why it is not? Because they are very sharp in sound. Whereas in India, we don't take much care of sound. Now it's changing. But so I learned a lot from sadhus. But sadhus has been always a passion. Then later on, I did another film on Kumbh Mela, following certain characters, and their whole, which was again very popular, very well received.
But that was later, after this first film?
After the first film, later. The next Kumbh, after 12 years.
It was always on the occasion of Kumbh.
Kumbh. Yes. Then I did another three films, a series of three films, which was not related with Kumbh. And that was to give viewers a more sense of what sadhuism is all about. So we took one Vaishnav sadhu, we took one Shaivite sadhu, one guru, I mean the Shankaracharya type image. So these were the three different aspects of sadhuism, the two different background of sadhus. Vanaghuri. There were three, Vaishnav sadhu and extreme was Aghuri. So this was co-produced with BBC, with French television and a few others. And we followed one sadhu called the Rolling Saint, which rolled from in Madhya Pradesh to Vaishnav Devi. We followed his journey. Amazing, amazing story, an amazing film. And then the other film was Aghori. And we followed this one particular.
That was specifically focused on Aghori only.
Just on Aghori, one character. What made him to become an Aghori? And he was a graduate. And his father was a principal in Bihar. So well learned person. It's not something which is
frustrated guy in your life.
Frustrated, and we followed his initiation and his guru. We talked to his guru, we followed him, we went to his village, we went to his cremation ground wherever he was doing his tapasya. And it's a very personalized story of his thought, what he thinks about Ghorism. I think that probably is the last film, because you don't see any.
What technique did you use to get things which normally people will not disclose to everybody?
I think it's the confidence of the other person. See, it was my father who went to this guy. I mean, this Aghori. First, when Rajesh went to him, or my father went, he will not talk. He rather threw stones at them, ki bhag jao yahan se, mere ko baat nahi karni kisi se bhi. But slowly, you take them in confidence, ki bhai, hum log wo nahi hai firangi jo aapko alag galat tarike se dikhayenge. Because that's what they are so afraid of, you know, that's what they are scared. Ki they don't, people portray them in a different way, in a wrong way. So my father was being an elderly person, he could persuade them, right, I am from the same area, I live here in Haridwar, I understand what you are doing, we like to do this with your permission, if you allow us, कि आपकी क्या सभ्यता है, आप क्या कर रहे हैं, क्या परंपराएं हैं आपकी, उसको हम प्रिजर्व करना चाहते हैं, लोगों को बताना चाहते हैं कि ऐसे लोग भी हैं, वो ये करते हैं, आपको किसी चीज से कोई लोभ नहीं है, you don't want anything, you don't have any attachment, you don't have attachment with your family, you have left your family, your father is well educated, he is a principal in a school, but still you decided to go for this, why? So all this kind of like we want to do in a film, so you make them understand. And that's how they agreed to do a film. And that's a unique film. Where you see him making his, collecting a skull from the riverbed, breaking the skull and making a bowl and worshipping it. And I can tell you, I mean, you, some people don't believe, are it's a fake, are some, aisi baat nahi. There are some. Aap bologe, do you believe in all this? I never believed in this. But there are certain moments when you start thinking or you're questioning yourself, is that right? I'll give you an example. There's a lovely sequence where the final moments of his initiation, a 12 years period of initiation. His guru is a tantric. Unfortunately, he died very recently. So this fellow is all, he used to spend all day and at the cremation ground where the bodies are burning all around, he will take clothes from there and he would eat from, drink from the same water, eat from the pyre, whatever left and all that. I am not going into detail of what he ate and all that, but so his guru comes and he just starts whispering, recording band kar dijiye, you're not supposed to record this, please don't record. I said, okay, we'll not record. And then he starts his initiation kind of process. So he, what is, don't stand here, because all these different gods would be, I'll be calling them here to witness this. So you can film only from this particular angle. And he chants mantras, you're filming, you're a cameraman, you're facing, you initiate her, you're Ramnath Nam Thaiska, Abhorika. I was so close up to skin. आपके एक्सप्रेशन क्या हो रहा है, उसमें क्या बॉडी में चेंज आ रही है, चेंज मत करता है, आंख में से उसके आंसू निकलते हैं, एंड ही स्टार्ट्स क्राइंग लाइक ए चाइल्ड, देयर इज समथिंग हैपनिंग टू हिम, यू कैन फील देयर इज समथिंग बॉडी हैपनिंग और इमोशनली सो स्ट्रांगली हैपनिंग टू हिम, देन यू स्टार्ट थिंकिंग कुछ तो बात है, देयर इज समथिंग देयर. It's not something, everything is drama or fake. So, kuch vidya hai, jo ki we are not aware, I would say. So, sometimes you get involved, you come up with.
India has a tradition, that's why there is a tantric tradition, Shivas, Tantras, and all those.
Very much. Again, then you have this extreme side of it, then we had. Shankaracharya of Kanchi with a huge following, a huge temple and huge karishma around him. The old Kanchi Swamiji which died, he was like a living god. And the film is called Living God. And we were so lucky that we filmed him alive, we filmed his funeral where he was buried. I mean, you could see women crying and not a devotion. Of people. Sometimes I look at my material, old material, which now I am putting it on hard drives now, all this tape material or film material. But still, all my material is still there in UK labs, which is being transferred on to for preservation, for archival purpose. Sometimes look at, I amazed myself, ki are itna kaam kiya humne, so much work we have done. Aajkal karna mushkil.
But actually, if you honestly ask now, it is more easier because you don't have to worry about camera jamming and footage problem, because wildlife you could sometimes shoot, so there's a hard disk happening and all that. So people would think on a superficial level or surface level, it's easier today in terms of technology providing, but still the working condition remains as hard as there. But why are you saying it is difficult now? Because people are more money minded.
सही आजकल के आप बच्चे पढ़ के निकलते हैं, उनको ये लगता है हाउ मच आई एम गोइंग टू अर्न एंड दे वांट इमीडिएट मनी. सी दे गो फॉर वन डे जॉब, दे वांट, दे एक्सपेक्ट मनी. इफ दे गो फॉर 10 डेज दे एक्सपेक्ट मनी. व्हाइल व्हेन वी वर वर्किंग वी वर नॉट थिंकिंग इन टर्म्स ऑफ डेज और वीक्स, वी वर वर्किंग फॉर मंथ्स टुगेदर और ए ईयर टुगेदर विद द एम टू प्रोड्यूस समथिंग यूनिक फॉर आवर ओन फिल्म. So once you are paid by it, you count days. अरे इतने दिन का पैसा मिला, इतने दिन का तो डिंग मिल रहा है, क्यों करूँ मैं काम? I know people personally who have said, if I work so much, if I give so much of material, who would hire me? So that's the mentality. See, technology is one aspect. Technology gives you free hand now. Every second person is a wildlife cameraman. Let me put it this way. Now you go to a sanctuary, I mean, all the jeeps would be full of cameras. All festive cameras, a lot of big people have come, which is more as a player for them, you know. It's much easier. Anything happens, you just either have a small camera or just click it and you are there. But still, the challenges are even more. With a video camera, press a button, fine, it will record, it will shoot. But again, you have to think. You have to think in terms of a story, you have to think in terms of a sequence, you turn in terms of different image sizes, plus the most important is the composition. What you are going to compose, how you are going to compose, how you are going to use the light, angle, lens. Are you on a normal lens or you want to use 600 which will throw your background out of focus to give a separation? All
again,
these things have to learn.
To focus also at that time.
Yes. All these things have to, where your dimag has to work. तो ये एक बड़ी बारी बात है. इस फाइन टेक्नोलॉजी इज ही चीपर कंपैरेटिवली बट स्टिल द चैलेंजेस आई वुड से आर देयर आर मोर. यू शूट सो मच, कुछ भी आया शूट कर लो. अर्लियर क्योंकि आपके पास लिमिटेड स्टॉक है, लिमिटेड रोल है, यू थिंक अरे यार ये शॉट लेगा, अरे कैमरे में इतनी तो फिल्म ही नहीं है हमारे पास. सो यू मोर सिलेक्टिव, मोर प्रिसाइज in your work, whereas you are not now.
Also, the last word, since you have experience of almost 4 decades or 5 decades, I would say, what is the, I would say, qualities required in terms of the human qualities to be a, I would not say successful wildlife cinematographer or documentary filmmaker, but what are these human qualities required if you wanted to go into the, for a new generation, if you want to go into the wildlife? Besides the technology, I don't know, human qualities.
Technology is one aspect. Technology I'm not going into, which is much easier. Ek word hai Hindi mein lagan, passion jise kehte hain aap. Jab tak aapke paas passion nahi hai, lagan nahi hai, और एक आपके सामने एम नहीं है, चैलेंज है कि आई हैव टू मेक दिस चैलेंज, आई हैव टू मेक ए फिल्म, आई हैव टू बी वाइल्ड लाइफ कैमरामैन वॉट एवर मे बी, तब तक नहीं कर सकते. इफ यू थिंक लाइक लॉट ऑफ पीपल इट्स ए फैशन, ओ आई लव वाइल्ड लाइफ, ओ आई लव वाइल्ड लाइफ, आई फाइंड वाइल्ड लाइफ यू लव, यू गो एंड हैव गुड टाइम इन द कॉर्बेट पार्क और व्हिचएवर पार्क एंड कम बैक, दैट्स नॉट अ,
दैट्स अ पिकनिक एक्चुअली,
दैट्स अ पिकनिक, दैट्स अ एंटरटेनमेंट. So for wildlife, I mean that's very precisely, you can count how many wildlife filmmakers are in India, or wildlife, leave aside filmmaker, I would say very precisely how many wildlife film producers in India who have survived, not even, except us, not even two or three. That's because it's so difficult, it takes time consuming, time involving. So not many people venture. And it's not enormous money, it's not a regular work. You make one film for 2 years, a good film, good behavior film of one animal, you need one, at least 1.5 years to make a film. So equipment costs are higher, वो सब ठीक है. Another, I'm not discouraging, that's the fact. I want to put facts to the newcomers to know what they are hoping in future, you know. I mean, it's good to say, oh, wildlife films are good, but what difficulties? The laws are becoming so stricter, the fees are becoming so high that a common person cannot afford. Not common person, even I cannot afford. Let me put it this way. Aaj aap Bandhavgarh mein film karne jao, the fee is almost 20-25,000 rupees. Plus your other expenses. You hire a jeep, your accommodation, it comes to 50,000-60,000 rupees a day. Can any Indian agency or the government can support you with that kind of funding? No. Simple answer. So you are dependent on the foreign. Now the big issue, as you issue about the salary in US and India, about the Devyanese, same thing. You go with your budget to the UK broadcaster or American broadcaster, he will prefer to give it to the UK person rather than to Indian. If he gives it to an Indian, he will give the Indian to the Indian, knowing well the Indian rupee value is so, that's the living standard are so, the costs are so. So the budget will be slashed down accordingly. So that's the tragedy. So that's why not many people are successful in this field.
Anyway, thank you very much.
I mean negative, but that's
no,
that's
not
the question of negative, that's the
it's
fact.
A fact. It's a fact.
So people should understand.